Greetings. My name is Melvin Jones, and I am the ministering evangelist of the Southwest Church of Christ, located at 380 Franklin Avenue in Hartford, Connecticut. And I'd like to welcome you all to our YouTube channel. And I pray that this message will enrich your life and cause you to make a radical change for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thanks again for tuning in, and may God bless you all. People said amen.
Amen.
God's people said amen again.
Amen.
We are blessed beyond measure to once again be in the house of the Lord.
Yes.
To be in the presence of the one that doeth all things well.
Amen.
To be in the presence of the one that holds our golden moments in the palm of his hand.
Mm-hmm.
And for that, we're ever so thankful.
Amen.
We thank God for directing our paths. Amen.
Amen.
Because we are blind and we are in a strange land and we don't know where we're going. So we thank God for directing our steps. So he can guide us to heaven's shores.
Yes.
Just want to echo what has been said a couple of times this morning. Happy Mother's Day, the most beautiful people in the world. Mothers, happy Mother's Day. We love y'all dearly. Appreciate y'all so, so very much. And we're grateful for the brothers that served y'all yesterday. If you missed yesterday's brunch, you missed a treat. And I know that this brother is humble and probably don't even want me to say this, but Brother Jay Parker, he catered that all. Oh, give him a Lord have mercy. A love deposit. Well, he catered that meal. Everything was good. Praise the Lord. We thank y'all. We just honored to be able to serve y'all. Appreciate all of our visitors and guests here, our honored guests, and we just pray that the word of God just touch everybody this morning in some kind of way. And allow us to make any necessary alterations that we need to make. And don't get upset with the mailman. I'm just making a delivery. The letter has been signed and sealed already. I'm just delivering it. You know, somebody said, signed, sealed, delivered, I'm yours. Yeah, around my age, I know what I'm talking about. God signed it and he sealed it and he delivered it through his messengers. And he says, if you take this, then I'm yours. It makes sense to me. There is a word in the book of Judges for us this morning. The book of Judges is kind of like a gritty book, dirty book. It's and when I say that, it because it's filled with sin. There are blessings, of course, in the book of Judges, but God's people are on this roller coaster ride. When they had good leadership, they was doing fine. Then the next thing you know, they slipped back into apostasy and idolatry. Another judge came through and got people right on track. They had peace, they had joy. And when that judge died or left, and then Israel went back into sin, and God turned them over to the hands of a heathen nation and severely oppressed them. This is an action book that probably appeals more to men than it does to women. While this book contains qualities that might appeal more to men than women, this particular chapter of the book of Judges actually elevates the position of women in Israelite society. In the chapters before us today, we are introduced to two women who were used by God in great ways for his glory. And these two women go by the name of Deborah and Jael. One was a respected leader in the nation, and the other one was just a housewife. They came from different walks of life, different cultures, different economies, different neighborhoods, but they were both used by God in remarkable ways. This morning, I want us to see how God utilized these courageous, faithful women to deliver his people from bondage and oppression. Mm-hmm. I want us to see that God is still using women today. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
For his glory. Every day, God is using women.
Amen.
For his glory. So let's talk through these verses together. And let's meet Deborah. Let's meet Jael. As I deal with the subject, women of wisdom and willpower.
Mm-hmm.
Women of wisdom and willpower. Now, although we call this day Mother's Day, although this narrative is surrounded and centered on two women, I believe that there is a word for everybody in this text. Well, chapter 4 of the book of Judges does not get off to a good start. The Bible says, and again they did evil in the sight of the Lord. Church, sometimes you and I are like the Israelites. And again, and again, and again, and again, we do evil in the sight of the Lord. Now, although you and I didn't get off to a good start, it is of the utmost importance that we have a good finish. Am I right about it?
Amen.
That's why we're here today, to make sure we have a good finish. At the conclusion of life's journey, and at the conclusion of this thing that we call life, we want to be able to say, I fought a good fight.
Right.
I finished the race. Amen. I kept the faith. So that's why we study on a regular basis. That's why we meditate. That's why we pray. That's why we worship. That's why we serve. That's why we love. That's why we sacrifice. So we can turn our bad starts into good finishes.
Amen.
So God, people, did evil again in the sight of the Lord. And God oppressed them for opposing him. Let us go to Judges chapter 4 and let us look at verses 2 and 3 once again. The Bible says, so the Lord sold them into the hand of Jabin, king of Canaan. And some of your version says Hazor. Hazor was a father of Canaan land. Who reigned in Hazor. The commander of his army was Sisera, who dwelleth in Harosheth Hagoyim. And the children of Israel cried out to the Lord, for Jabin had 900 chariots of iron, and for 20 years he had harshly oppressed the children of Israel. Notice that the text says that God sold his people to a heathen king. See, when we sell out on God, he sells us out to the enemy. God will give you over to folk who will oppress you, and you will have no strength to withstand their wrath. God will give you over to circumstances that will oppress you, and you will have no strength to withstand its wrath. To be oppressed, it means to be crushed or burdened by abuse of power and or authority. The reason why so many people live in a state of oppression is because they are sellouts. And because they are sellouts, God sold them out. The Israelites stopped worshiping the great I Am and started worshiping idols made by hands. They stopped living for God and started living for self. And the Bible says they were crushed and burdened under the power of Jabin, the king of Canaan. Church, Israel was petrified because he had an army that consisted of 900 chariots. See, chariots were the tanks of the ancient world. They were made of wood or iron pulled by normally one, two, or three horses. Some chariots had razor-sharp knives extending from the wheels, and it was designed to mutilate the helpless foot soldiers. Israel had no strength to withstand the wrath of Jabin's army. Therefore, Israel was oppressed severely for 20 years. The helpless armies of Israel was no match for its enemy. According to Judges 5 and 8, the Bible says that Israel had no weaponry. They were depleted, and they were defeated. Then one day, Israel decided that they had enough. They had a wake-up call, church. And when they had a wake-up call, they called on the Lord. One of the tragedies in this life is that some folk never wake up. If we really want to be delivered from the oppressive effects of evil and the harsh whip of chastisement, we must deal honestly with our sins before the Lord.
Amen.
I ain't saying nothing.
Amen.
Our goal should not be just to have an easier time in life. Our goal should be to be right with the Lord in every areas of our lives.
Amen.
If we could ever learn to just seek the Lord's will above all things, we could be spared a lot of hardship.
Amen.
Listen, life is already tough.
Yes.
The Bible says we're going to suffer as Christians. Why bring on more suffering?
Amen.
So they were oppressed. Look at verse 4 of the text. The Bible says, now Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel at that time. So here we introduce the Deborah, a prophetess. A prophetess was a woman with extraordinary knowledge and wisdom and piety and instructed in the divine knowledge by the Spirit and was accustomed to interpreting God's will to his people. Deborah was not the only prophetess in Scripture. There was Miriam over in Exodus 15. There was Huldah over there in 2 Kings. There was Nodiah in the book of Nehemiah. There was Anna in Luke chapter 2. And in the book of Acts, there was the daughters of Philip. Now, Deborah was instrumental in conveying to the Israelites the things of religious matters and the things of civil matters. Any issues you may have, you could go to Deborah. She was influential and was held in national respect. A whole nation respected this woman. Deborah was also married to a man named Lapidoth. Now, although the record does not give us any evidence of Deborah being a mother having her own children, she was without a doubt the mother of Israel. And here is why. In verse number 5. And she would sit under the palm tree of Deborah, between Ramah and Bethel, in the mountains of Ephraim. And the children of Israel came up to her for judgment. Deborah would sit under the palm tree instead of disputes among the people of Israel. If you ain't get along with somebody, you and that somebody will go to the palm tree. And Deborah will set this thing straight. You having some issues with your children, and you just can't seem to get them to do right. She took them kids up to the palm tree, and Deborah will set things straight. Your husband was a knucklehead. Take that husband if he would go. All you gotta do is say, Deborah got some collard greens under the tree. Let's go. Just get him up there. Deborah will set this thing straight. They came to her with their problems and she rendered judgment. She was the mother of Israel. She was a woman of wisdom and willpower. I'm so thankful to God that we have some Deborahs among us that we can consult with in the time of need.
Amen.
Somebody need to say amen.
Amen.
We all need at least one Deborah in our lives. We need somebody we can talk to about our troubles, discuss our disappointments, converse about our controversies, chat about raising our children. We need a Deborah so we can mention our mess ups, vent about our vexations, express our experiences, point out our pitfalls, hash out our hurts. We all need a Deborah so we can verbalize our vulnerabilities. We need a Deborah in our lives. Every woman under the sound of my voice should have a proverbial palm tree because everybody needs somebody.
Amen.
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 Aren't you glad you had a mother like Deborah?
Amen.
A grandmother, an aunt,
yes.
A sister,
yes.
A stepmother,
yes.
A church mother, as your Deborah.
Yes.
We need more women that are wise as a serpent, but gentle as a dove.
Amen,
amen y'all.
Amen.
Yes, Deborah was a wonderful woman. But in Hebrew literature, her name means a bee. Yes, like a bumblebee. And I'm glad we have some bees in the church. Y'all like Deborahs. Y'all like bees. Industrious like bees. Social like bees. Oh, Lord, y'all are definitely social like bees. Y'all don't talk too much. Y'all just social like bees. That's all I'm trying to say. Busy as a bee. Y'all are sweet as a honeybee. Y'all like flowers like bees. test. Y'all seem to know what's going on. All others are like inquisitive, sisters are inquisitive, but some women just got this special radar. Like my mother, boy, she got a radar. She be knowing how in the world you know what's going on. Grandma, how you know we was across town doing what we had no business doing? Radar. Like the mother said to a little boy, boy, little 20-year-old son, boy, you've been to the strip club, haven't you? Mama, how you know? Yeah, Ma, I was there. Did you see something you ain't had no business seeing? She says, yes, Mommy, I saw Daddy in the front seat. She was a woman that was easy to love. She was easy to talk to. She was sentimental, influential, and instrumental in the life of God's people. Now, although they came to Deborah for judgment, she was not judgmental. Amen. See the difference?
Yes.
She wasn't judgmental. So my beloved mothers, my beloved sisters, embrace your palm tree. When you find people that are coming to you for guidance and encouragement, embrace your palm tree. You have been called to have a palm tree. Your tree might be at home. Your tree may be at school. Your tree may be at work, at church, in your community. You never know when somebody has the need to sit under your palm tree.
Mm-hmm.
Never know. And when they come, when they do come to your palm, be a woman of wisdom and willpower.
Yeah.
So verse 6 and 7 of the text goes on to say, then she called for Barak, the son of Abinoam, from Kadesh in Naphtali, and said to him, has not the Lord God of Israel commanded, go and deploy troops at Mount Tabor. Take with you 10,000 men of the sons of Naphtali and the sons of Zebulun. And against you I will deploy Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his multitude at the river Kishon. And I will deliver him into your hand. Deborah receives a word from the Lord. She calls Barak, said, man, get 10,000 of your boys and go to war with the enemy. The Lord promised to defeat Sisera, the Canaanite general. God promised a great victory. And if they will simply trust him, all you got to do is go and you will have the victory. Church, there are times when God will use a woman to encourage a man to go forth in the strength of God.
Amen.
Yes, he will.
Amen.
Yes, he will. Here we have a woman telling a mighty man of valor to fight against Sisera, commander of a ferocious army. Sisters, if you have a husband that is not faithful as he should be, then use your home as a palm tree.
Amen.
And you become a bee. Encourage your husband to be proactive in the things of kingdom business. Advise him to attend all of the men's seminars and the men's retreats and opportunities to be a better man.
Amen.
Tell him to be on time. As a matter of fact, tell him to be early.
Amen.
Encourage him to be all that he can be in the Lord, and the Lord will be with him.
Amen.
Now, in order to do that, my beloved wives, it will have to take a real Deborah, because that means you got to sacrifice your honey-do list so the work of the Lord can go forth.
Amen.
Yeah, I didn't think I was going to get too many amens on that.
Wow.
See, honey-do this and honey-do that might have to wait sometime when the Lord is calling.
Amen.
Deborah had a God-first mentality. She had a God is my priority mentality. I'll take care of the house and the kids. Honey, you just go ahead and be about our father's business. Listen, the day, all you're going to get is a stronger man.
Amen.
Think about it. You're going to have stronger sons, stronger brothers, and every woman has the right to be led by a spiritual man.
Amen.
Every woman
Amen.
Has that right to be led by stronger men. Every woman deserves that right. God calls for every man to be strong.
Amen.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Turn your Bible to 1 Kings chapter 2 real quick. God calls for every man to be strong. Now, I'm not coming down on men in this text, but I just want to point out some things that we should be aware of. And I ain't making this stuff up. The scripture screams loud and clear that men should be strong. Now, in 1 Kings chapter number 2, David is about to die. And the advice that he gives to his son is the advice that every man should take heed of. In 1 Kings chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, what does the Bible say?
Now the days of David drew near that he should die.
Keep reading.
And he charged Solomon his son.
Okay,
saying,
keep reading.
I go the way of all the earth. Be strong.
Be strong.
Therefore, improve yourself a man.
Stop right there. Wow. I've been all over this earth. I've done a lot of things. My son, I done been there and done that.
Amen.
Be strong. Improve yourself a man. How do we do that, David? Keep reading.
And keep the charge of the Lord your God. To walk in his way.
To walk like God, sound like God, look like God, smell like God, live like God. Read.
To keep his statutes.
Keep his statutes.
His commandments.
His commandments.
His judgments.
His judgments.
And his testimonies.
His testimonies, read.
As is written in the law of Moses.
Keep reading.
That you may prosper.
Yes.
In all that you do.
Yes.
And wherever you turn.
A strong man is not predicated on how many weights he can lift.
Amen.
How good he can fight.
Amen.
A strong man is the one that keeps the word of God. A strong man walks in the ways of God. A strong man keeps his statute, his precepts, and all of his laws. And then he said, you will prosper in all your ways.
Amen.
Brothers, don't you want to prosper in all your ways?
Amen.
To be strong in the Lord. See, we are commanded to be strong. And everyone has the right to be led by a spiritual man. So Deborah encourages Barak to go to war because our God has heard our cry. And we are sick and tired of being severely oppressed. Well, how did Barak respond to Deborah's words? Let's take a look. It's in the book. Go back to Judges chapter 4, verse 8. This is Barak's response to the Lord's charge. And Barak said to her, if you will go with me, then I will go. But if you will not go with me, I will not go.
Wow.
I only got one word to that response. Lord, have mercy. That's a shame. Deborah gets the word from the Lord. She shares it with Barak. And she finds Barak seemed to be afraid and timid to follow his word. He is willing to go to battle, but only if a woman goes with him. Now, God commanded Barak to go, not Deborah, to go all the way up to Mount Tabor to fight those ferocious Canaanites. Barak's request shows that he trusted in human strength and not in God's promise.
Amen.
Lord have mercy. See, a person with real faith steps out at God's commands, even if he or she must do it all by themselves. Even if the odds are against you, there must be countless times when a woman told her husband, her son, her brother, her father to go forth in the strength of God, but he refused. Church, I heard a preacher recently say, and I had to think about this for a minute. I heard a preacher recently say that if all the men, all the boys just left the church, all of the sisters that are left, they will find some kind of way to keep something spiritual going. But if all the women left the church and it's left to the brothers, it won't be nothing going on. An old preacher said this, and I had to sit and think about that, and all I could do is shake my head and say, Lord, have mercy. In Philippi, there was no synagogue. There were no men to lead spiritual things. But guess what? Lydia led prayer service down by the river. When Jesus died and was buried and was taken to the tomb, guess who got up early in the morning and went to the tomb? The sisters. But we was back somewhere sleeping, scared, and the sisters got all the things they needed to anoint Jesus. But who was there? The sisters. Thank God for the sisters. Women of wisdom and willpower. May this text serve as a lesson for the Deborahs to speak up and for the Baraks to step up.
Amen.
And I'm talking about me too, fellas. I ain't coming down on the brothers, but this is just a reality check for us. Verse 9, the Bible says, so she said, I will surely go with you. Nevertheless, there will be no glory for you in this journey you are taking, for the Lord will sell Sisera into a hand of a woman. Then Deborah arose and went with Barak to Kadesh. Deborah said, of course, Barak, I'm down, man. She didn't even hesitate. She said, surely I'll go with you. See, not only was Deborah a loving and wise woman, Deborah was a straight up, no nonsense, ride or die sister.
Yeah.
So enough.
Yeah,
go to war.
Yeah.
See, Deborah had a little hood up in her. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Her name means B, and she was ready to stay. Thank God for the ride or die women in the church. We need y'all. See, when you have a ride or die mentality and go to the end of the earth, you have the end of the earth mentality, that changes things.
Yeah.
One day, Esther went to the king and had a request that could have cost her her life, but she went anyway and saved all her people. That changed things. Esther was ride or die.
Yeah.
Ruth was ride or die. Left her family back in Moab. Followed Naomi and took on a different culture, a different religion.
Yeah.
Married Boaz, and she became an ancestor of Jesus. She changed things.
Yeah.
Rahab was ride or die.
Yeah.
She let the enemy stay in her house.
Yeah.
She could have been killed for that. And her whole family was saved as a result. And she was an ancestor of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Rahab was ride or die.
Yeah.
Our mothers, grandmothers, great-grandmothers, were ride or die. They worked in the fields, worked in the factories, cleaned other people's house, took care of other people's kids, and so we can have a better life. Amen for the ride or die sisters in the church.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for all of the dedicated Deborahs that you have raised up for your glory. Deborah said, all right, I'll go with you. But you ain't gonna get no honor, Barak. All of the honor's gonna go to a woman. Listen, in times of war, it was a shame for a man. No honor to a man. Because of winning a war, the honor's gonna go to a woman. There is not much to be said about a man with no honor. Here God is setting Barak up to receive honor, but he's too timid to obey God's word. A man of honor. A man of honor. Turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2 real quick. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Before we read that text, I want you to listen to the words of Solomon the wise man in Ecclesiastes 6 and 1. He says, a man to whom God has given riches and wealth and honor, so that he lacks nothing for himself of all he desires. A man of honor lacks nothing. See, when you have God's honor, you lack nothing. A woman don't want a man who ain't got nothing.
Well, amen.
She needs a man who can offer her some spirituality in her heart. And be a man to step up and be a man and raise those kids and take care of his wife.
Amen.
And all of the things that need to be taken care of.
Amen.
In 2 Timothy chapter 2, drop down to verse number 21. Brother Coley, what does the Bible say?
Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter,
keep reading.
He will be a vessel of honor.
Hold on. Cleanse yourself, my brother. And be a vessel of honor. I implore every man under the sound of my voice to pray to God so that you could be a vessel of honor. Now, I'm not saying that you're not, but be even more of a vessel of honor. I pray that prayer frequently. Lord, I just woke up this morning and I thank you. Use me today as a vessel of honor. Use me today to touch somebody with your word or with my deed. Lord, I don't even need to know that you use me in that way. Just use me in that way.
Amen.
To touch somebody. Keep reading.
Sanctify. And useful for the master. Prepare for every good work.
See, if we are not vessels of honor, then we are not useful to the master.
Amen.
And if we are not useful to the master, we are useless.
Amen.
Every man of God should always strive for God's honor. And maintain that honor.
Amen.
So Deborah said, yeah, Barack, I'm going to surely go with you. Church, it was unheard of for a woman to go to war with a man. Or even to just follow the troops to war. But being the ride or die woman that she was willing to travel approximately 75 miles north from Ramah Bethel all the way up to Mount Tabor was about 75 miles without train, planes, and automobiles. They had to stop and pitch tents. There were no other women around. She had to be with all these men. Had to eat the rations of the food. That was a rough life. And she said, surely I'll go. She didn't appear to be one of those prissy women that was worried about her pedicure and her manicure. She wasn't worried about getting her hair messed up. All right, we got to go through this terrain. We got to cross over this stream. It's raining. There's wild animals. There are robbers. Surely I'll go with you.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. She had wisdom and willpower. So, from verse 10 all the way to verse 16, Barak gets his troops together and the Israelite army, and they defeated Sisera, the Canaanite army. But in verse 17, it says that Sisera got away. Let us investigate. Judges chapter 4, drop down to verse 17. However, Sisera had fled away on foot to the tent of Jael, the wife of Heber the Kenite. For there was peace between Jabin, king of Hazor, and the house of Heber the Kenite. Here we are introduced to Jael. Her husband's name is Heber. Now, there is history between the house of Heber and Jabin, the king of the Canaanites. They were boys. They were good friends. So, of course, Sisera felt safe going to Jael's tent. Oh, man, that's my boy wife. How you doing, Jael? Let me in. I'm running for my life. So in the next couple of verses, Jael invites Sisera in the tent. She gave Sisera some milk. He talked a little bit, gave him a blanket. And Sisera, he gets comfortable, so he says, all right, Jael, just stand by the doorpost and make sure nobody comes in and don't tell anybody that I'm here. Now, another reason why they wouldn't think Sisera is in the tent because it wasn't right for a man to be in another's tent that wasn't his wife.
That's right.
I think I need to say that again. It ain't right for a man to be in another woman's tent.
Amen.
Just wanted to drop that.
Amen.
The sisters are like, yeah, say it again, Brother Jones. So, sister is comfortable. He falls asleep. He's fatigued. He was just at war and he had a long journey. He's exhausted. So he falls asleep. Drop down to verse 21 of the text now. Then Jael, Heber's wife, took a tent peg and took a hammer in her hand and went softly to him and drove the peg into his temple. And it went into the ground, for he was fast asleep and weary, so he died. Now, somebody said, that's what he get for being in another woman's tent. Now, although JL was just a mere housewife, I want us to notice something about her. JL was ride or die too. Now, her husband was good friends with the man she just killed. What does that say about her character? She didn't care what her husband thought. She was going to do God's will. Amen. Now, she was not disrespectful to her husband, but she said, God comes first. Amen. She could have been severely punished or killed for doing what she did. But she was ride or die. She says, I'm in it to win it for the Lord. Amen. See, in those days, women were integral in making tents. Do you know how much force of inner strength and outer strength to take a peg and a hammer to walk up to a military commander and place his sharp tip right on his temple and with all her might with one blow bang that peg down into his temple until he died.
Yes, Lord. Right at that.
So enough. So what is the application here? No matter who lives in your house, no matter what they do or what they believe, you hold fast to God's law.
Amen.
You hold fast to his precepts, his ordinances, and God's word. You do what's right. So in conclusion this morning, verse 22 through 24, the Bible says, and then, as Barak pursued Sisera, Jael came out to meet him and said to him, come, I will show you the man whom you seek. And when they went into her tent, there lay Sisera dead with a peg in his temple. See, she left it there so they could see it. This is what I did. So on that day, God subdued Jabin, king of Canaan, in the presence of the children of Israel. Verse 24, and the hand of the children of Israel grew stronger and stronger against Jabin, the king of Canaan, until they had destroyed Jabin, the king of Canaan. Because of the wisdom and the willpower of two women, a whole nation was no longer under severe oppression.
Yeah,
because of the wisdom and the willpower of two women,
amen,
a whole nation enjoyed peace.
Amen.
Thank God for all of y'all, Deborah's and JL. Thank God for your wisdom and your willpower. Thank God for your sacrifice. Thank God for your service. Thank God for your selflessness. Thank God for your insight. Thank God for your sincerity. Thank God for your smile. Thank God for your submissiveness. Thank God for your steadfastness. Thank God for your sanctification. Thank God for your sweetness.
Amen.
Sweet as a honeybee. Thank God for all our sisters and all our mothers. Thank God for all the Debras and JLs. Thank God for all the bees in the house.
Amen.
You might be here today, and you may be wondering, well, I'm wandering through this land, and I don't know where I'm going, and I need some direction. And the only direction that's the right direction is in Jesus. How do I get in Jesus? Well, you heard his word already. But we just pray that you believe that word. Believe it with all your heart. And not only with belief, because belief is an action word. Gotta repent of your sins and say, I'm gonna change my life around. Right now, we like Israelites. Sometimes we're like Israel and we sin and God bless us and we sin and God bless us. No, but you need to come in and get washed by the blood of the Lamb. Until you likewise repent, you will all likewise perish. Luke 13:3. And then you must confess the sweetest name on mortal tongue, and that's Jesus is the Son of God. And then you must be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. That's how you get Christ Jesus. If you're not a member of the Church of Christ, you need to be one today. And be surrounded by all of these women of wisdom, all of these brothers of wisdom, and have a new family, new hope, a new life, a new walk, a new talk, new insight, new perspective, a new transformed mind. So, to all of our mothers, we love you better than cooked food. A mother is she who can take the place of all others, but whose place no one else can take. To the world, you are a mother, but to your family, you are the world. Happy Mother's Day. And let us all stand. And I want to thank you again for tuning in to the Southwest Church of Christ YouTube channel. I pray that this message has caused you to make some changes in your lives. If you have any questions regarding the message, feel free to give us a call at any time, or feel free to send us an email, and we'll be glad to give you a Bible answer to your Bible question. Thanks again for tuning in, and may the Lord bless you in a very special way.